I'm not been a fan of the engagement we've had with the AFL over many, many years now. And I think that's the sad thing about it. It used to be in the past, we had unknown Australians trying to woo our players out to their AFL league. Now we have ex-Gaelic players doing it, which really saddens me that that's what we've got now. We've got recruits for the AFL within our own ranks of the GAA, and that's sad.
Do you see that almost then like the enemy within?
Well, it's something that you knew was going to happen. All you need to do is get a few players out there first and get them sort of involved to some degree, and we find that most of them come home and haven't made it out there at all, and often don't even play as good a Gaelic football when they get back. But now they've got a different role. Now they can be agents for the AFL, and it's an absolute free gamble for them. If our players succeed out there, that's a cheap gamble, and if they don't, they send them back home to us to see can we continue to play football with them.
Alright, that's Mickey Hart speaking with the BBC earlier on this week, obviously in the aftermath of Colin McShane heading down to Australia for what looks like a 2-week trial at the moment. I'm delighted to say we've got Tadhg Kennelly on the line. Tadhg, I know you must have been very interested listening to the debate that's been raging back in Ireland at the moment about this. Again, Mickey Hart kind of been in the vanguard of people complaining about the relationship between the GAA and the AFL over the years. I know you're not currently recruiting for the AFL, but you have done that in the past. So when you heard Mickey's comments, what did you think?
Morning, boys. Afternoon, it is here in Sydney. Well, up the coast of Sydney. Look, it's nothing new. Obviously, the comments, you understand. I understand where he's coming from. I can see both sides of it. Of course, he's going to be disappointed. When you look at Cahill getting an opportunity, and obviously Conor McKenna's another one, of course, from Tyrone. But I understand Mickey. I understand the fact that he doesn't appreciate the relationship with the AFL. I understand that he's trying to protect his own backyard, as I would if I was a manager running the county team at home and one of my star players was being given an opportunity to go play a professional football, professional sport.
Are you surprised though that this attitude continues to exist in Ireland where somebody goes off and has, in Colin McShane's case, a 2-week trial it looks like at this stage and maybe a contract at the end of that, but an opportunity to go away and be a professional sports person?
Yeah, look, again, I'm not sick of it, but I understand that it's a consistent theme that comes, that pops up regularly. And I understand the frustration with people at home in the GAA, that the fact that they're going to lose, I suppose, their star players to another court. But look, the argument can be thrown many ways. You're going to lose players to rugby, you're going to lose players to soccer, you're going to lose players to... a lot of situations are happening in county boards at the moment where the players aren't treated properly. So there's lots of... I think the media jump on the one and it's an easy target as far as players going over to Australia playing AFL. No, when it is an all-star player getting an opportunity, obviously there's going to be a lot of media publicity about it. And the other fact that we call is AFL list lodgements. I'm an assistant coach at the Swans now at the minute. AFL list or lists, which is basically you're playing list, the final list has been lodged for the 2020 season, so he can't play this year. So he'll be playing with Tyrone in the championship this year. He can come out in July if he does get a mid-season draft, which is highly unlikely for an international player. Generally, a mid-season draft in the AFL is for a club that's had a number of injuries in a position where they can actually go to a lower league, like the VFL or the Waffle in Western Australia, whatever, and pick up a player and put him straight onto the list so they can fill a spot where they've had injuries during the season. So he can't play this season. So he'll be playing for Tyrone in the championship.
Can you just clarify that? Cause I don't think anybody realised that. I think that everybody assumed that this would happen straight away. He can't go. Could he go out on a developmental contract and not play and like play second tier? Or is there?
He can't. No. If he's going to be on the list. And if he doesn't play, if he's not on the list and he plays with a second tier team, he doesn't qualify as an international rookie, which means he's got to go into the draft next year. So he can't play AFL this year unless, like I said, he gets into a mid-season draft in the middle of the year, which is highly unlikely for an international player, and that's in July.
Yes.
So I think what they're doing is obviously giving him the opportunity to have a look at him. I know Kyle when I was working and recruiting. He was part of the players we looked at as an 18-year-old. And it was he was one that actually came to the Combine in Dublin and just wasn't appealing to the AFL clubs that were there.
Just out of interest, like, have you ever had conversations with Mickey Hart himself about this? Because he says in that same BBC interview, it will be a far better future for him if he stays at home, which seems like a fairly big generalisation about any one man's future.
Yeah, I'd love to have a conversation with Mickey, no problem. I'd love to sit down with him and tell him the pitfalls of staying at home, the pitfalls of going and playing a professional sport. There's always pitfalls to anything that you do, but there's also positives, and I'm a pretty positive person, glass half full type of guy. My understanding, or my reading of the situation really is obviously not too happy with the situation. It hasn't been for a long time. It hasn't been a fan of the international rules where we've played and get to represent. Well, there's a lot of people aren't fans of that, but he hasn't been a fan of the code and the relationship with the GA and the AFL for a long time. But look, I appreciate his opinion. He can have his opinion, and he's been very strong on it for a long, long time. Look, of course, there's pitfalls to staying and going to the other side of the world. His comments about players coming back not playing better. Well, there's examples of him the other way. Colin Begley came back and has been fantastic for a long time with Leash. You know, Brendan Murphy was the same when he was at the Swans, went to Carlow, came back. Chrissy McCaig, who was at the Swans, went back, is dominating with his club and captain of Derry. So there's examples the other way, and there's examples everywhere. And to say the players go out and come back lesser players, I think that's a throwaway comment for me.
I presume it's based on Kyle Coney, really, who obviously was out with you guys, I think, in 8-10, and hasn't really kicked on to be the type of footballer that everybody assumed he would be on the basis of his career.
Yeah, well, Colin never lasted. Colin came 6 weeks out, and that was it. So if you're going to look at the Kyle Coney example, that's more of your own development program in your own county, as far as why Kyle hasn't gone on and played and established himself as a senior, one of the most talented minors or footballers ever to play the game. Mm. And so that's nothing to do with the game of the AFL, the journey of going playing a professional sport. It's more of your own development programs and why players like that slip through the grips.
Yeah, I think there's probably it's a hoary old cliche at this stage that players come back from AFL a bit broken. That the intensity and the load is so high for these players. It's such a physical sport that it's difficult for them to recover.
Nah, and it's right. It is a throwaway line. It's a line that's been thrown away for the last 25 years ago. Probably was when it was, you know, applicable. But now you look at the physiques of Gaelic footballers, and you often see that when I see the international rules and. The physical size of the Gaelic players are bigger now and stronger. And I think it is an issue with some of the Gaelic footballers at the moment. I think they've swung too far the other way. That's another argument. But whereas the AFL players now, the game itself has gone totally the other way. They're very conscious of concussion. The physical side of the game is almost being taken out of the game. Only right because of what was going on in the game, we'll say 20 years ago or odds, you know. I still say to people that, I play a lot of championship games at home and play from the stall at home, and I'm watching my back more in those games than I ever did in a 12-year career with the Sydney Swans, a professional athlete.
There's been a couple of different things floated tonight. There's obviously been this kind of a throwaway comment about perhaps compensation for clubs, which probably won't get into because it's hard to know where that begins and ends. But the one kind of concrete piece...
I'll actually say that to you, actually. I went to Andrew Demetriou almost 16 years ago now. And said that I wanted my club compensated. Said no problem, and went to the GAA, and the GAA said no, we can't do it. It seems to be paying for our players. I was 15 years ago when I actually asked AFL were willing to do it, and the GAA kicked back and said no.
That's interesting. Was that because they felt like they don't actually own the rights to the player, and so that would have ended up because the players would then have had the argument. Well, if you're charging for us, then you have to pay for us.
That's right. Exactly. Spot on. You know, and I just find it very interesting that the AFL has no problem because that's what they do here. No different to the soccer, or obviously that you compensate a club, and that's what the AFL do here for players that are recruited from a junior club. They get compensated, and when the player plays 50 games, 100 games, 150 games, they get a certain amount of money to the club.
The point I was actually trying to make, Tig, is what we actually have seen the GAA do, or what we have seen counties do, and. Kerry have, something that was circulated on social media last year about this project to keep players at home, to provide them with a dossier mm-hmm. of available courses, available jobs and things to keep them mm-hmm. at home. Like, would you be encouraging counties such as Tyrone to perhaps have a look at that, to perhaps not just yep. try and keep people at home, but to give them all the available suite of options at their disposal?
100%. You know, and like I said at the start, on, you know, if I was sitting there at home and I was the manager of Kerry, I'd be doing everything possible I could to be, you know, the talks with David Clifford. What would you like, David? How do we make these young men want to play for Kerry football and make it appealing for our under-20s and 17s and whatnot coming through to stay at home? Because it's hard to stay at home at the moment, as we know. You know, there's not a whole lot of jobs and there's not a whole lot of opportunities at home. So how do we do it as a county board? One, as far as job opportunities, and two, obviously the development programs that we set in place where actually these young men are progressing on to the next stage of their careers and actually adding some value to the senior inter-county team. And that's certainly a program that you'd be looking for. And not, I suppose, you're going to get caught in the media limelight of we're losing a player. We're always going to lose players. You're going to lose players to alcohol. You're going to lose players to drugs. You're going to lose players to society and social issues. You're going to lose them to other sports. And it's about limiting the impact of how that happens. And if there's a common trend in it happening, well, then you got to do something about it and try and stop that. And that's the same in business as it is in sport.
Are you personally happy that you're not involved in the recruitment side of things yourself when you see these sort of stories rage up every so often?
Not really. I enjoyed giving opportunity to young men playing that I got. And that's what was most appealing to me at the time. When I finished playing, I just saw, I suppose, there was a lot of stuff that was going on at home as far as recruiting from AFL clubs. It just wasn't nice. It was becoming a nasty underworld where young players were getting offered opportunities at 14 and 15. And, you know, they got to live their lives at this stage. You can't be offering opportunities. And I made it a, you know, basically went to the AFL and said, look, we got to clean this up and we're going to make it where if you want to get drafted to the AFL, you've got to be 18 years of age or 19 years of age and put protocols in place for Irish players coming out and clean it up a bit because it was just getting out of hand. And, you know, I've never said no regrets to it. I'm very happy with what I've done. I'm very happy with what I'm doing at the moment, coaching.
Ty, can we just go back? You said Colm McShane was at the combine that you were organising. Yeah. He would have been an 18-year-old. What has changed that suddenly a couple of clubs are actually interested in him? Has he physically improved? Has he got better as an athlete, do you think? What happened there?
My initial opinion of him was obviously lightning speed and a bit erratic, I think, with his composure and born land. And obviously we've seen that clean up quite drastically. I also think probably clubs are willing more now than ever in Australia to take a chance on a 23-year-old, which normally in the past they wouldn't have, because, like I said, of the physiques now of the Gaelic footballers, that the players now are ready to play almost when they come over and play, which is highly unlikely for a player to play in his first year once they get to an AFL club. But it's probably that he's physically ready, whether he can play the game you know, in the first few months. It'd be a huge challenge for someone to make that transition so quickly.
So what would that process be if he comes over and does well in that two-week trial with Adelaide? What would happen then?
With Brisbane.
Brisbane, sorry, yeah.
Yeah. What would happen, they'd be continuing on. We'd probably offer you a contract if they were happy with what happened and how they saw it. Send him back home, continue on his year, obviously. They'd more than likely try and get him back out again throughout the year when it suited his fixture and whatnot, and then obviously sign him in early October, November as an international rookie.
Right, so that's how that would work. It's actually the Crows. The Crows said that they've got him on trial for 2 weeks, or they've got I think that just came through late last night. It's an interesting scenario where Tyrone felt that they obviously had lost him and they might get one last year out of him. So that might be a win-win for everybody where he gets to go and have the crack at a professional lifestyle and has one last season to say goodbye, and who knows where that takes him.
Yeah, and that's right. You know, I think I often say to people, you know, that are quite negative in the whole thing about, and I understand it, like I keep saying to people, you know, I understand the sports situations, I understand being a Kerry man, I want to win all Ireland, and I understand it. But I also throw back to them, can you imagine your 18, 19-year-old son, if you had a son, or a brother getting an opportunity put in front of him, and you said, no, I don't want you to do it. I want you to stay at home. It's a very difficult thing to do once it's put in front of you as any footballer. And that's kind of the argument I put back to people about, you can't stop them from doing it, and you should be encouraging them just at least look at the opportunity in front of them, whether they like it or not, and it's not for everyone.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that, like, what is the point of helping our young people to develop through sport if it's not to ask them to be their best selves? And your best self is trying everything that comes your way and having a look at it and going for it. And then if it doesn't work out, we're a safety net for you because we're part of your community, and we actually encourage you to go away and come back to us.
You couldn't be more spot on, Joe. I think that the fact that as a club, or with the store limits of my own club, they should be extremely proud of the fact that I was able to go away and play because of the development they put into me and go and play as a professional footballer. And they've always been there for me, like you said, as a safety net. But you want to develop your players to become the best they can. If they go on to be All-Ireland medal winners, if they go on to represent their county, if they go on and become professional footballers at soccer or rugby or AFL, whatever it be, well, you've done a fantastic job and you should be very proud of yourself.
Tyke, just a final one for me. Can you give us a scoop on who the next athletic prospect from the GAA might be from the AFL's perspective?
Oh, God. I've been out of it now for too long. I would not to tell you this right now. As far as what I've been doing the last 3 years now is coaching the Swans. And I will say we've picked up Barry O'Connor from Wexford, a 21-year-old boy. He's been very, very promising over the preseason. He signed a 2-year deal with us, and he's taken to Dr. Water, really. So, yes, he's been very, very good, very strong, big man. So who knows as far as Barry's career has gone.
I can't let you go, Tiger, without asking you about the situation in Australia at the moment. The bushfires are on the front page of all the newspapers here on an almost daily basis at this point. And they just have been continuously raging to the point where they were centre of our news for ages and then kind of drifted away over the last week or two. But things haven't got any better, unless the rain over the last 24 hours might have helped a little bit.
Yeah, no, not much rain, really. I'm up the coast, actually, up in Queensland, up in Hampton Island, which is about an hour or 2 hours north of Sydney. We've had a 3-week break off, so we had the Christmas. I'm just finishing up. But, it's been horrendous. It's quite scary or spooky, I suppose, when you're in your own house and I'm in the eastern suburbs of Sydney, which is not too far from the coastline, and you've got ash on your car and all over your house. You know, when it's that close to the city and obviously you see the damage that's caused and the amount of, you know, people homeless and the lives that are lost, and the size of the fires. You know, it's hard to comprehend it, I suppose, when you come from a small country town like the Stone, you're looking at the size of these fires and the acres that have been burnt, and the work that people are doing to try and stop it. It's quite scary, and it's not the biggest natural disaster this country's ever had.
Yeah, I presume people are not really talking about much else at the moment. Is there a sense that there's going to be a change on the back of this? Is there a political movement being born?
Yeah, it looks like there's a lot of political game going on at the moment. Obviously, the climate change issues has been a thorn in this country for a long, long time, and the government that's in place at the minute haven't been really, I suppose, forthcoming in the way they've approached the issue of climate change. And Scott Morrison, the government at the moment, the Prime Minister, has copped a bit of criticism for the way he's handled the whole situation now. A lot of people talk about the preventing, they can backburn here, which is obviously trying to prevent the fires from happening when they can burn beforehand. But there's been a lot of issues with obviously the environmental control of creating fires and the damage it's doing. But there's some serious political issues going on at the moment, and you could see some changes because he's under a lot of fire.
Well, look, we hope they get them under control sooner rather than later. Ty, great to have you with us, and thanks very much. Enjoy whatever of your holidays is left.
No problem, lads. Thanks for having me.